Hey guys, John here from John's DIY Playground. Hey, it's a very exciting day here today at the playground. I'll tell you why, because this particle Electron came in the mail today, and I pledged on Kickstarter almost a year ago for this. It was originally going to be ready for October of 2015. Here we are in February 2016, but they've lived up to their promise and delivered. So here it is. The Electron came in a little padded mailer here, and is wrapped in plastic here, like in case you get into a rainstorm, it'll still be fine. So let's open it up and see what we've got, alright? Anyway, so it's easier to read. Outside of the box, Electron, of course, it says it's got a GSM radio. I'm in the United States, so this is for North and South America. I know they do have radios that they've tested and worked on in other countries around the world. And basically, what is it? It's an Arduino that has cellular support instead of just Wi-Fi or no-fi in some cases with Arduino boards, but has everything you need. It's got a 2,000 milliamp hour battery. The breadboard comes with a data plan, a SIM card, and in the U.S. dollars, it's about $2.99 a month for a megabyte of data. So that's interesting, exciting, so on and so forth. So let's bust into this thing and see how they got this set up. That's kind of cool. Little plastic case, kind of like a kit opening up. Good presentation of the whole thing. Visiting this website, I guess, to get more instruction. We'll do that, and I'll tell you guys about that in a little while. Must be the SIM card itself. We'll have to bust that out and figure out how to use that. Whole bunch of hardware inside of here. Just get this pad out of the way. Here's the Electron itself. Looks very nice. It's got a connector on the end, a micro USB for power, and then it has connector on the end here for antenna, external antenna. I don't know a whole lot about it other than it's got a lot more pins than some of the other particle offerings, like the particle photon, which is a nice Wi-Fi board. And of course the sticker that you gotta have. You gotta have a sticker. USB cable. Nice to have extras of those laying around. This must be the battery in here. Looks like there's some play components, some LEDs, couple resistors, a photo resistor as well. And last but not least, I think probably must have the antenna. So they worked with this other company, I believe, to develop this antenna, and it's probably a good enough antenna for around here. I get pretty good reception in my area with Verizon and other towers. So let me get this fired up and demonstrate it for you real quick.
Now, before we get started with something in the cellular world, I highly recommend what I've discovered. It's this documentation at the Particle.io website, and I'll put a link below. But it describes a lot about what consumes data and how cellular works and what it has to do every so often, like pinging and handshaking once a week. All these things use up data. So if you're just planning to run your device 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and it's constantly connected to a cell tower, that's going to result in some data use. And let's say significant enough data use, because we're only given 1 megabyte per month as the standard rate. So I looked in the documentation and I kind of came up with a quick calculation, because I was wondering how much would I use if I just left it on and connected to the tower all the time. So we know that the thing has to handshake. It couldn't be up to 6 kilobytes worst case, so we use that, say, 4 times, so once a week, that's 24 kilobytes of use. Pinging must happen every 23 minutes, so for 30 days, that's 122 bytes per ping. There's going to be 1,879 pings in a month. That's using about 231K. So we add that up, and even not doing any over-the-air flashing, not sending any data packets back and forth, just basically sitting on the network, it looks like you're going to use up about 25% of that 1 megabyte of use that you're allowed for the $3 in the US. So there's also warnings in the data about, you know, not using HTTP client and sockets because you use a lot of data. So they're highly recommending not using that. Instead, you use the particle.publish functions that are basically established for use with either Photon or this Electron. and it's much more efficient. So keep that in mind when you are designing your sketches. So the particle comes mounted on a breadboard. And if you've never used a breadboard before, you wouldn't know maybe that the connections are like this. Then there's a break, and then like this. So when you're connecting things to them, that's how a breadboard works. And this was kind of an interesting idea. I thought it was a good idea for beginners, is to kind of help with the first circuit and show where the components should go. So they're saying, use a pen or a wire and poke a hole where you see the X's. Well, again, good idea, but unfortunately not great execution, because the A0s and the A5s, it looks like it lines up, but if you take a closer look onto the side, you will see that where it's supposed to be A5 is actually lined up with the A4, and the template's a little messed up here. So it doesn't quite line up. For my first sketch, we're not going to use that. We'll use the onboard LED just to demonstrate. But I just want to point out, and it is in the documentation on the particle website, that they caught that they know the first versions, first people who are going to receive this particle, the template is a little bit off kilter, but good idea. Will be improved again and fixed in later versions. So for our example, we're going to control an LED over the internet. The LED itself will be located on our Electron at digital pin 7, which is where the onboard LED is at. So it'll make it really easy to get it working. So that's why we have the integer LED 1 is D7. Then the setup, we have to tell it, this is pretty standard Arduino type stuff, the pin mode for LED 1 is an output, and it's the LED. Now we're going to define this function. The function name that we're going to respond to when we send to the web from our web page, we're going to ask for it to run LED. When it sees that, it's going to run a function locally on the Electron called LED toggle. Now that function is actually down here. It starts here, and it's described what to do. So what if you look at this code and inspect it, it's just saying, okay, if you've got the command to go on, throw the LED high, in other words, turn it on. Otherwise, if the command is off, then send a command to go off. Simple, and then it returns response to show that it actually did what we asked it to do. The loop section is interesting because we actually don't do anything. We're really just waiting for cloud commands in response, so the thing doesn't really do anything in the main loop. It's all in the setup and in that function. And then this is just an initialization so that when the program first starts, ensures that D7 is turned off. So that's the one of the two scripts that have to be written, and this will be flashed to the Electron. The other end of it is our local code. It's an HTML file that has to be written for a web page that we're going to show locally on our computer. So it's pretty straightforward, but the only things you have to figure out and change in this code is going to be your device ID. So you have to tell it what device you have, because you could have several Electrons or several Photons or whatever. Then it actually says call this LED function that we defined in the other script that you saw, and then the other thing you have to fill in yourself is the access token. So where do you find device ID and access token? If you go back to the online IDE, if you click on this gear, you'll see a section where it shows the access token. I'm not going to show mine because I don't want to share that. And the other part is devices. You may have several devices, so you actually have to show your devices, and then you would click on the device that you want to send the flash to. If you click on this, it'll open up and show the device ID. And that's where you just copy that and you drop in your device ID right here. So once you get that all set up, you can save this as an HTML file somewhere, like on your desktop. And then we would go ahead and flash the firmware. We're going to do it over the air since this is a pretty small program, and send it to the Electron directly. One comment in my assembling of everything, the only really problem I had or concern was snapping on the antenna for the first time. It was a little tight, so just be careful with that and go slow. So I'm going to select that I want the Electron to be the thing that I flash to in this case, and then to actually flash, you just hit this button right here. So it's saying, here's a warning, you're going to be using at least a few kilobytes if you do this. So they recommend downloading the app and flashing it via USB. That is somewhat complicated. I don't want to get into that here, but we'll flash over there anyway. It's not that big of a program. So now it's saying it's going to flash the code. I'm watching the light and the status on the Electron. It's still just breathing cyan. Now it just turned magenta. It's flashing. It went offline for just a moment. It looks like it's re-handshaking and now breathing cyan again. So the code is uploaded. D7 is off. So let me compile or finish putting the code into this section here, and we'll demonstrate how it turns on and off.
All right, guys, so moment of truth. Just so you guys know, this LED here, for reference, this is the breathing cyan, as they call it, when you are connected to your cellular network. And this is D7, just up and to the left of it a little bit. That's already turned on. I ran the script once to see and make sure it was going to work right. So now you can see I've got on my web page here that simple script that they made. So I'm going to say that I want to turn the LED off now. And you can see after I click do it, maybe I'll just focus in on the Electron right now. So you can hear from when I click the mouse here, I'm going to click it right now. 1 1000, 2 1000, 3 1000, 4. About between 3 and 4 seconds. That's about what it took to also turn it on, I noticed. So it is working. It's really good. Very happy with it. I'm going to have to really think about how I strategize with my bits and pieces of code and put this thing to sleep when it's actually not working, and then I don't want to keep it connected to the cloud so I don't hog up a lot of data and waste it just on just kind of sitting there and pinging. So anyway, guys, hope you liked it. If you have any questions, please leave them in the comments below. This is John, and thanks for watching John's DIY Playground. Hope you subscribe, and we'll see you in future videos. Take care.